They say that life is not fair, but in reality, life is full of choices, and we each have to make them. One wrong choice can be devastating, with the impact of changing our whole life. Some choices lead us down a dark road of no return. No one starts out with the mindset of wanting to be addicted to drugs or anything else. It can be peer pressure or wanting to escape the stresses of life, only to realize that your life is becoming a nightmare and a reoccurring cycle of drug abuse and arrest. It becomes just a daily quest for survival. Families are torn apart and lives ruined. This is the story of hope and redemption. It is about change, from being lost in a world of drugs and chaos to a new life of promises and peace. It doesn't happen overnight. It is a process. Tracy Lindsay knows the scenario all too well. Tracy herself is a survivor. But now, with the help of the Christian community, Tracy is helping to make a difference in lives that were once thought to be hopeless.
We have been investing in the lives of women for more than 2 years at Tetelestai House. We have watched as God has turned messes into messages and tests into testimonies. We have seen daughters welcomed back into their families, mothers reunited with their children. We have witnessed restoration and redemption. Tetelestai House is designed to reach women coming out of jail or prison who want to change their life, but we are seeing a ripple effect far greater than that. It is our goal at Tetelestai House to equip each resident with the tools that she will need to persevere, to be a productive citizen, to become the mother, the daughter that God has designed her to be. My name is Tracy Lindsay. I was born and raised in Omaha, Arkansas. I'm the director of Tetelestai House. We minister to women who are coming out of jail or prison. That is just what I do. What I am is a born-again Christian, and I have dedicated my life to serving Jesus Christ. At our ministry, we are all about redemption, and there is no better way for you to hear about that redemption than the stories told by the women that are impacted by Tetelestai House. So over the next few moments, you're going to hear their stories. My name is Tracy Lindsay. I'm from Omaha, Arkansas, and I'm the director of an organization called Tetelestai House.
My name is Mandy McPherson. I live at the Tetelestai House in Omaha.
My name is Denise Tucker. I'm from Harrison, Arkansas.
My name is Kaylee Mays, and I live at Tetelestai House in Omaha, Arkansas.
I'm Stephanie Jean Hankins. I never realized that I had a serious problem. That's the lie. You see, that's a stronghold, and Satan will come in and he will build that stronghold, which is nothing but a lie. And he'll make you believe this, this, or this when you're totally disconnected from the truth. And the truth was, I was an addict. I was a drug addict, and I was hooked on morphine. But I would have argued with you from daylight till dark that I wasn't. What happened was, I committed a crime, and I went to jail. And they gave me my medicine in jail because it was all prescribed by the same doctor and it was all filled at the same pharmacy. So it was legal. They gave it to me in jail. And they withheld it from me once and I detoxed and it was horrible. But immediately when they got it back, I was like, yeah, give it here. And then they withheld it from me a second time, and I detoxed a second time, and it was worse than the first. And then they did it a third time, and I did something that I should have done way before then, but I knelt down and I cried out to God, and I didn't believe in God. I didn't believe in Satan. I didn't believe in anything. But I cried out to God, and I said, God, I can't do this anymore. And as crazy as it may sound, I know that I heard in my heart, you don't have to. I'm going to help you. And the next day, they got the morphine back, and I refused it. And I continued to refuse it, and I got sober. I was in jail for 13 and a half months before I went to prison. I'm a Powell graduate, Principles and Applications for Life. I got to work there in the Christian barracks there at the McPherson Women's Correctional Facility. And I didn't know where I was going, but I knew that I would be involved in jail and prison ministry for the rest of my life. And how I knew that, I couldn't tell you, but I knew that. And the chaplains there talked to me about Tetelestai House. And it's so funny to us now because Tracy came to the prison for a Powell retreat. And we did cardboard testimonies, and there was a photograph taken, and like, I'm here, and about six people over, there she's standing, and we didn't know each other. I had been praying for the house. It didn't even have a name at that point, I don't think. I came home, and I stayed with a friend in Harrison for about 30 days, and we didn't know if the board would accept me, because originally the rules were different than they are now, and I was coming out of prison. At the time when the house opened, it was just for women coming out of Boone County, the Boone County jail system. So 30 days later, I moved in, and I've been here ever since. There is absolutely no better feeling in the whole world than to know that you're where you're supposed to be when you're supposed to be there. You see, they gave me a chance. I came here as a saved person, but I lacked social skills. I had a prison mentality. I had different goals. I wasn't here very long before I went back to college. But every person that gets to come through our front door is worth it. And I want to help them see their worth. You've got to stop believing the lies that you've believed about yourself. You've got to stop calling yourself bad things. You've got to stop referring to yourself as a drug addict or a drunk or a junkie or addicted to anything, because those are all lies. Those are all things that Satan uses to keep you down. You don't have to be that person. When you come to faith in Christ, He calls you holy. He calls us His. And because He's no respecter of persons, see, what He has done for me, He can and He will and He wants to do for everyone. God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. All you got to do is come to Him like a little child, and He's already there. He's already waiting for you.
My name is Kaylee Mays, and I live at Tetelestai House in Omaha, Arkansas. I was going to a boyfriend's house, and I had a fifth of whiskey under the seat of my car and a bag of cocaine. And I remember that I could not start my car because I was shaking so bad because I needed to drink. That was the point where I knew that my life would never, that I would always... I thought I would always have to have something. The first time I was arrested was 3 days after my 18th birthday. I was just barely old enough to go to jail. I was with a guy who manufactured methamphetamine, and we were using, and I got into the car with him, and he was on parole and didn't have a license. And the town that we were in, a lot of the police officers knew that. And we went to the liquor store and came out, and they pulled us over. And I searched the car, and I got caught with marijuana and syringes. And so I went to jail for it the first time. I've been arrested for everything from trespassing, battery, possession, obstruction of governmental operations, distribution charges this last time, theft, fraud, forgery. minor in consumption of alcohol, possession of paraphernalia, and I went straight from that addiction into a whole new addiction to crystal methamphetamine. That took over my life in such a quick, just, I look back and can't even wrap my mind around how it happened. I don't know where. In a year's time, I lost my home. I lost my vehicle. I was arrested 9 times in 4 months. I was in an abusive relationship. I lost my mom in January of this year to a drug overdose while I was incarcerated. And after I'd sobered up and gave myself a few days to, you know, let some of that stuff out of my system and let everything sink in, like what had just happened, just a little bit of clean time, I looked at the wreckage that I myself had caused that I couldn't blame anybody else for anymore. I was in jail. Nobody put me there. I put me there. And whenever I started taking ownership and saying it was me that did this, I can't blame my mom dying. I can't blame my childhood. Well, I was sitting in jail and I prayed. I said, God, I don't want to go back out there because if I get out, I've got nowhere to go but back to the same place. There'll be a bag of dope waiting for me and money, and I can't do it. Please open up a door. Please do something because I can't do it on my own. So while I was sitting there in jail on a Sunday, we had a woman that comes in and talks to us on Sundays. We have church in jail in the pod. And she came in and started talking about Tetelestai House. And she said that it's a place for women coming out of jail and prison who want to change their lives, that they take you by the hand and carry your load for you so you don't have to do it by yourself, that it's a place that you can go. And I thought that is exactly what I need, that place is put there for me. So I said, is there any openings? She said, yes, there's 2 openings. And so I asked her for an application, and she brought it to me. And the jail administrator said that they would get me some other applications for rehabs and things like that. And I just felt a tug at my heart saying, no, just trust me. And I remember whenever she brought me the application, or whenever, right before she brought the application, she said, what are you going to do if you don't get into this place? And as just as honest as I could, I said, I'll go right back to doing what I was doing. If I don't, this is my last hope. I have no other choice. You know, that's my choice if I don't have a place to go. My feeling when I walked in these doors, I didn't know what to expect. I was very standoffish. I had been hurt a lot in the last year. And I walked in and they were making dinner for me. The 2 other girls were. And I walked in my room and I had to wait almost a month before I could come in because, you know, with court dates and things like that. And they had, as soon as they found out I was coming, they started giving me clothes and buying me things, and they had me dinner made when I came in. And I remember walking into my bedroom and just crying. When I left jail, I had nothing but a pair of pants on that I had ripped because I gained weight from getting off the drugs. So when I came in, I had the clothes on my back. That was it. And I came in and just immediately I felt like I had a family. I felt like it was home, like the most incredible, overwhelming feeling, just awesome. It's not a fear of returning to the old life. There's nothing for me to return to. There's nothing out there to go back to. It's not a fear, but it's something that I need to be aware of. Just stay close to the Lord. It's scary to walk out now, but I'm lucky that I don't have to think about that for 9 months. So I get to, you know, plenty of time to soak up just the goodness of this place and the love, and, you know, continue to bond with these amazing women. I didn't make friendships here. I made family here. It's not friendship. It's family. I made family for life. Without a doubt, I know that. I know that if anything, even I'm not going to, but even if I were to go out now, I know that these women would be there forever for me. And I know that whenever I leave here, the Tetelestai House will go with me. Whenever God chooses to let me go, you know, I'll be here for 9 months. I'm going to finish the program, but I know that these women will always be in my life, especially the girls in the house. We've been through this thing together and watched each other grow, and it's just family, just relationships that you can't form with anybody else. I would tell you that it's never too late, and that things can change if you want them to, but you have to want them to. And pray. God is faithful. He knows your heart, and just pray that he makes a way, and he will. He promises to.
Your personal decisions in life have brought you to this crossroad. Those decisions have made you a danger to yourself and to those around you. You cannot undo what has already been done. In this life, there are consequences to every decision. As you enter these doors, your decisions will be made for you and about you. Within these walls, you are separated from the world you left behind, and now will begin existing where time does not move. A minute is like an eternity. There is no day. There is no night. There is only time to reflect on how you got to this point or what might have been.
My name is Denise Tucker. I'm from Harrison, Arkansas. Kind of grew up around this area, Green Forest and Bergman. Moved away a few times, spent a little time in Dallas, Texas. And the last few years of my life, I've been back and forth kind of between Branson, Missouri area, and my mom still living in Harrison with my kids. I would go visit her in Harrison. I went to a friend's house to smoke a joint, and they had methamphetamines there, ice instead. And I tried that, and it took over my life. So for the last 5 years, I'm 19 months clean, but for the 3 years before that, I was a very serious addict. I lived back and forth between Branson and Harrison, and it was a vicious cycle. I would use because I wasn't allowed to see my kids, but yet I wasn't allowed to see my kids because I was using. I would sell drugs to support my habit, and then just be so high that I couldn't go around my family or my children, and then feel bad for not being around them, and then get high again to numb that out. I tried to change my life by myself, and I would try it. I would try to make these steps and try to find some place to live, and try to get on my feet. And the only places I had to go were straight back to people that I know that used, or staying with people that were still using. I had heard of Tetelestai House, but it was vague. They're like, this lady named Tracy has a house in Omaha and she wants some girls to come there. She's trying to help them. And I'm like, I can't go to Arkansas. I live in Missouri. My profession's in Missouri. I'm like, well, it's not for me. And then I heard about it again. They're like, no, it's like a home for women, you know? And I'm like, still, I blew it off because it's in Arkansas and I was on Missouri probation. And then the third time I heard about it, I went to a chapel call, and she was standing there. And she's like, we're working with Missouri in probation and parole. She's like, fill out an application, and we'll see if... And she's like, you look so familiar. And I'm like, no, you look familiar. I'm like, where do I know you from? And we were sitting in chapel, and they were doing the message, and it kind of hit us both at the same time. We were in prison together in 2010. And the recognition hit us, you know, like, wow. So I didn't know that I had got approved to come here. And the judge in Taney County had approved me to go to rehab. They're like, you're on a no bond. We're not letting you out. If you find a rehab or somewhere to go, I'll release you there. But I'm not just going to let you out. And I didn't know that I was approved to come to Tetelestai. It was about, I sat in Taney County probably about another 2 or 3 months before I found out that I was approved. And then after I found out, it was another couple months of getting my attorney in contact with Tracy and then getting in front of the judge. And God worked that all out.
We go in front of the judge, and the judge is like, looks at the credentials of Tetelestai, and they're like, yes, I want her to go there. It looks like a wonderful place. And Missouri Probation and Parole stand up, and they're like, you can't send her there. She's on probation. And that's out of state. She needs an interstate compact. You can't legally send her there. And the judge looks over at a minute. She's like, how about this? I'll suspend her probation and order her there on her new case. And so the judge, God worked that out right then and there. So my release from jail was to come here. And to me, looking for that place to go, looking for a place to get on my feet, and a place to continue what I started in jail, and to grow in Christ, and to find out what He wants me to do, and not what I wanted to do. This place is amazing. I got to come here from jail. I felt love. 40 years of looking for love. That's what I felt. I didn't have to look anywhere else. I didn't have to go anywhere else. I was home. And I can relate to some of the girls here, but like some of the women from church, they've never had addictions or anything, and just they loved me anyway. Nobody was judgmental. I walked into the church that first Sunday, and they're like, we've been waiting for you for 7 months. And they all knew who I was, and nobody cared that I was tattooed up and an addict and used to sell drugs, and nobody cared. They just loved me. And they see the new me. I pray every morning. I devote my body to God. I felt that I was delivered of addiction when I was in jail. I haven't craved it. I haven't wanted it. It doesn't tempt me. But I don't want to give Satan that entrance either. So I dedicate myself to God every morning. I have also reconnected with my mom and my two boys. They're 13 and 11. They've spent the last 5 years at my mom's. And I get to see them all the time. They call me when they have problems now. They look forward to my graduation date. This is a one-year program, and I feel it's very needed. It gives you a chance to establish the new life and to kind of just get on your feet and know how things work. I really don't know how it's going to go when I graduate. I have an idea. This place, I think, once you're here, you're pretty much here for life. These people are with you for life. They become your family. Tracy and Jean, Missy, I love them all. And I know that I have a calling, I believe, to go into ministry. If you come here, God has something for you. God has something for your life, you know, and He has something for everybody. But to be able to focus on that, and that I know whenever I graduate from here that I'll still be following what God wants me to do, working with them, whether it's side by side and hand in hand, or if it's a phone call away. I believe they're in my life for the rest of my life. If you are at a place in your life where it is uncontrollable and unmanageable and you feel nobody loves you, nobody cares, that nobody understands, that to tell you the truth that somebody does, that there is people that care, and number one, that God cares, and that Jesus gave His life for us, and that love and that help is just a phone call away. It's just a person away, just to reach out to somebody. I've just recently filled out paperwork to become a counselor in training, to be a substance abuse counselor, and I can't wait to help others. And I posted that on Facebook, and several people were like, you already are. And so things like that, you know, I don't see it, but other people see it. And anybody that knows who I used to be, manipulative, lying, cheating, stealing, I'm not that person anymore, and Christ did that. I've changed my life here at Tetelestai House. It's a safe, violence-free, drug-free home that I can grow in Christ and become a woman that He wants me to be and a mother that He wants me to be. Okay.
Being incarcerated is a cold, stark reality and the end result of a life out of control. There is nothing routine about it. Your life is now a government file. Your identity is part of the public record. Your fingerprint is the mark of who you are now. Being in the wrong place at the wrong time and making bad decisions will usually end with heartbreaking results. You have plenty of time to think about how it could have been different.
My name is Mandy McPherson. I live at the Tetelestai House in Omaha. At age 14, I began drinking alcohol and going to parties and smoking lots of marijuana. It was occasional socially on the weekends, and then it became quite the every night thing. I would sneak out of my parents' house, and it was an escape from myself. I was kind of a depressed kid. I felt like I didn't fit in. I wasn't pretty. I wasn't liked, so I didn't have to deal with all those problems. At the age of 18, I realized that I had a problem and couldn't turn back, couldn't stop using. It affected my schoolwork greatly. When I was 18, I was already a mother and married before I graduated high school. I just felt like I couldn't live without it. Like, when I was pregnant with my children, I still smoked marijuana, but I didn't do methamphetamines or drink. I was in and out of people's houses. I dealt drugs to support my habits, so it wasn't hard to find a place to sleep. I slept in my car for a while. I met a man. We lived together. I got pregnant with my youngest daughter, Emma. That relationship didn't last long. I just looked in the mirror one Friday morning, and I was using while pregnant with her and realized that I had a problem. So I admitted myself in rehab, spent 90 days there. Remained clean until after I had her in September, and then immediately began using again. Like, I was functional for a while, or thought I was functional, being a good mom. It was about 3 years ago, my parents, they lived in West Virginia, they called me and realized they moved away just to get away from my problems, I think. And they called me and said, "We know you're having problems, let us come and get Emma." So they come and got my daughter and moved. She lived with them. And then it was just horrible. My life was horrible. Sold drugs, just in and out of different houses, slept in my car. I found a wallet at the dollar store, and I used the credit cards in there to buy things, to trade for my meth habit, to pay off my dealer. And then I would sell. It didn't matter who I was selling to, kids. I mean, I'm sure I broke up families and homes. The first time I went to jail, I was 19. And it was just for hot checks, which of course I wrote a check to buy some drugs. And my mom bailed me out, which I didn't spend a night in there. Then I've been to jail in Searcy County. Or we're just not going to court because I was too high to go to court. The longest period I've ever spent in jail was like 2.5 months. It was always, I can't wait till I get out of here to do it again, until the last time I went to jail. Because I accepted God in my heart as my Savior. He just changed everything. Like, I went and turned myself in that following day, and I was never so excited to go to jail. Tracy and the girls from the Tetelestai House had went to my mom's church in Lead Hill at First Baptist. They'd given their testimonies, and my mom had been praying for me for years. I know it. And they gave my mom some paperwork. And she had given, I was off doing my thing, getting high. They didn't know where I was at. But my friend Jeff had contacted me. And he had talked to my parents, and they had gave him the papers to the Tetelestai House. He came and found me and tried to get me to call Tracy and tried. He called her a couple times, and she told him that she couldn't do anything until I reached out. And I called because I knew something had to change. I couldn't live like that anymore. I couldn't. I was so broken and hopeless. And I contacted Tracy on December 1st. She met me at the end of 281, a little church, and led me to my Lord, my Savior, Jesus Christ. She told me I had to turn myself in because I had warrants. And I said, "Well, I'll wait till tomorrow. I got to go talk to my parents and my family." And they tried to convince me, and she's like, "Well, if you need a ride, contact me at noon tomorrow." And I called her and said, "I got a ride. I'm going to jail." And I'd never been so excited to go to jail. Well, like the times before I'd been to jail, when you hear those doors shut, it's like, oh, man, again. This time it was just like, a sigh of relief, like that life is done. Like, I don't have to do that anymore. I was scared. I mean, I was scared. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know what it was going to be like. But when I pulled in that driveway, the girls come out and they loved on me and told me, welcome home. And it felt like home. As soon as I walked the doors, it was home. I've been here 6 months. Before I got a job, we would wake up and do praise and worship and circle around for prayer. And I missed that so much since I got a job. Like, that was the most amazing time. And we'd do basic seminars and just learn about God and all about Him. Probably the first month I was here, I would think about it. Like, have cravings, Jones, as they say, but not anymore. I have a plan. When I graduate from the tea house, I'm moving back in with my parents and my youngest daughter. I have to be under my dad's authority for a while. And then I'll continue working. And there's mornings I wake up and I'm like, Lord, it's all I can do is get out of bed. But I know through you and your help, I can do this. You'll give me strength. And He does. Like, it's wonderful. Whereas before I knew the Lord, it was run out and buy a bag of dope to fix my problems. Now it's not like that. When I graduate from here, I'm going to still be involved in the tea house ministry. It's just amazing. Like, that's my calling. Because I want to work with women coming out of jail and prison. I would tell you that there's hope. That there is, look at me. I was an addict for almost 20 years. I'm not now. God filled that void. You don't have to live like that anymore. Man, accepting Jesus as your Savior. Hitting your knees and your face and pray. Because He loves you. You're not alone through this. And I mean, He's been there with you through the whole thing, but He saved me, He can save you.
There are no easy answers for a life spiraling downward. But the answer can be found. It all depends on how bad a person wants it and how strong the determination is to see it through. The path to self-destruction started with one step in the wrong direction. The strength to reclaim a life requires one step at a time in the right direction. There is help, and there are answers.
My name is Tracy Lindsay. I'm from Omaha, Arkansas, and I'm the director of an organization called Tetelestai House. For 16 years of my life, I was addicted to methamphetamine. When I was 18 years old, I was at a party, and someone handed me a plate full of methamphetamine and asked me if I wanted to try it. And for the first time, I tried it without ever thinking how it would impact my life when I'm 40. I was immediately addicted. I began to sell to supply my habit. So by the time I was 21 years old, I was in prison the first time for sales and distribution of meth. Had a career path set out. You would ask anyone from my hometown, hey, what's Tracy going to do when she graduates? It would have been go to college, play ball, and go be a coach. At 18, I was just at a party with friends and buckled to peer pressure. That one decision changed my whole life. So you continue to chase that first high that you had. I continued to chase it for the next 16 years of my life. I mean, God's word, it says that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I had a little bit of support, but a lot of it was enabling, so it wasn't a good positive support system. When I was 21 years old, I was incarcerated for 1 year in the Arkansas Department of Corrections, and the entire year I was there, I knew I was going to use again. I couldn't wait to get out to use again. I kept it together for about a year, year and a half, as soon as I learned the system of parole. When I would be drug tested or when I would be visited, I began to use again. And I was a functioning addict for about 4 more years. At that time, I walked out on my family. I left my husband and my children and anyone who ever mattered to me. And I moved in with a man who manufactured methamphetamine. And for the next 6 years, my life spiraled out of control. In 2010, I was arrested for manufacturing methamphetamine. I had enough charges to offer me 30 years in the Arkansas Department of Corrections. While I was there on a 3-year sentence, I realized that something had to change. I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. I didn't want to go back to the lifestyle I came out of. While I was incarcerated, I went into a program called the PAL program. It's Principles and Applications to Life. Every day I was hand-fed the gospel of Jesus Christ. I sat in a classroom atmosphere, and women that were never leaving that prison invested into my life and set me down and told me who Jesus was, what He had done, and who I could become in him. I one time heard a Bible verse. It was, one day we will all be held accountable for what we have done in the body. And that got my attention, and I started to listen a little more, because for 16 years, I had done a lot in the body that I did not want to be held accountable for. I think the truth of the gospel truly set me free. A truth that transforms is truly a truth, and the truth of the gospel that Christ had died for my sin. In 16 years of addiction, you commit a lot of sin. In 33 years of life, I had committed a lot of sin. I had done a lot of things that I would one day stand accountable for in the day of judgment. And when I heard what Christ had done for me on that cross, on that day, that I could be forgiven of everything I had ever done and I could have a new life in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things have passed away and all things become new. I embraced that scripture the day I heard it. I could have a new life in Christ, and I needed new life. On September 14th, 2010, I got on my face in a prison cell. And I cried out to my Lord and Savior, and I asked Him to save me, to use me and use me up. I wanted, if one person could benefit from my 16 years of addiction, then I would be willing to share that. I was released from prison the day before Thanksgiving in 2010. I paroled out to my dad. I put myself back under his authority and found my church home at Lakeland Baptist Church. And just got back into life, just a routine life. I had no idea how to live just a normal life. I had been getting high for 16 years. So just putting myself back in my father's home and just getting up every morning and going to work, doing routine things, going grocery shopping, things like that, I hadn't done for a while. It was a culture shock for me. When I first got out of prison, I couldn't even be in Walmart for more than 10 minutes at a time. Just a culture shock for me. I still struggle every day. Life is not perfect just because I'm a Christian now. My biggest task isn't what I'm going to wear today. I have normal life struggles every single day. How I handle them is what is different now. I find my strength in the Lord. I don't do things in my own will. Every morning I wake up with the knowledge to manufacture methamphetamine. So every day I wake up and I dedicate my mind, my will, and my emotions to God. This organization was formed. We had a couple at our church that had been praying about this residence that they have on their property that they were not using. And they prayed for about a year, and one day they stood up at church and donated this house to a ministry for women who are coming out of jail or prison. So immediately, we formed a board of directors. I work for 10 board of directors. They're my advisors. And we meet once a month and just come together and see how we could better the facility. This house just happened. It's crazy how it just happened. 2012, November of 2013 is when we were incorporated, and things just started happening. We took our first resident in April of 2014, and we are taking in our 14th resident next month. Tetelestai House is Greek for "it is finished." Those are the last words that Jesus spoke on the cross. You can find them in John chapter 19, verse 30. The director of missions at our North Arkansas Baptist Association had actually preached a service the day that the couple donated the house. He preached a service on fire raining down from heaven. And the couple donated the house at the end of that service, and he named the house at that moment Tetelestai House. We want our women who are coming here to know that old way of life can be finished and that there's new life to be found in Christ. If you come to a point of brokenness, of true brokenness in yourself, and you're sick and tired of being sick and tired and you just don't want to go on, my first advice would be to cry out to the Lord. Ask Him for help. He's sovereign. He's just. He will help those who ask. After you do that, women coming out of jail or prison, I noticed when we would ask them where they're going, when they leave jail, they were going back to the house they got arrested at. You have to change your people, places, and things. In the beginning, I wasn't accepted. I had many wrongs to make right, but I had told the Lord that if there were ever anything that I needed to make right, to put that in my path, and I would seek forgiveness there. And He has on more than one occasion. But it is awesome to see how the public is responding to this house, because they did see my name in the papers. They did see me on the front page 3 times. They did hear about us on the news. So they also now get to see Christ within me and what has changed in my life. So it was important to me to open this house in Omaha. Oftentimes people will say, aren't you scared that you went back into the community you came out of? But I really wasn't. I've really embraced the new creature that I have become. And with the surrounding area, they're not in town where they used to be. They're not inside the city limits of town where they did their business. So pulling them out into the country is a little bit of a breakaway for them. Yeah, I would just say to anyone today to never give up. You're never too far gone to be redeemed. God's arm is long, and if He can pull me out of a 16-year addiction and restore life to me better than I have ever known it before, He will do it for anyone, because He is not a respecter of persons, and I was no one special. We want to thank you for taking time to watch our video today. If you need more information about Tetelestai House, maybe you or yourself, someone you know, has trouble and is struggling, you can contact me at Tetelestai House at 870-426-4988. You can also visit our website at www.tetelestaihouse.org. Thank you.